Good morning, everyone. So today we'll discuss abdominal uterine bleeding and we'll focus on adenomyosis and fibromyoma. So when we say abnormal uterine bleeding, you have to know what is the normal bleeding, alright? So normal menstruation blood loss that come very common in MCQ is get how much blood is lost in the normal period. That is around 80 ml, okay? You remember that. Normal blood loss is 80 ml. And what is the duration? It is around 2 to 7 days. That's the normal period. It is sometimes associated with pain, it is sometimes associated with cramps. There may be some clotting disorders, and when there is the formation of clots, many things can happen. So when we say abnormal uterine bleeding, it may be increased bleeding, it may be less bleeding, it may be associated with cramps, it may be associated with other disorders, and so many things are there. Okay, so we basically classify abnormal uterine bleeding into two types, structural and non-structural. So some structural causes and some non-structural causes. So when you say structural causes, the very common mnemonic is there, it's called PAM. And non-structural causes are called COIN. Okay? That's universal, okay, you get it in the books also. This is universal mnemonic. So PAM and COIN. So starting from the non-structural causes, which are not related to any deformity in the structure. Okay. C for coagulopathy. Okay. And O for any sort of ovulation disorders. When there is ovulation disorders, ovulatory disorders. Then E for any sort of endometrium causes like endometriosis. Then I for iatrogenic, any sort of surgical trauma, any sort of surgical trauma or induction because of overdoses of medicines, okay, or surgical trauma that can also cause abnormal uterine bleeding. This is iatrogenic. And for non-specified. So these are the causes of abnormal uterine bleeding when there is no deformity in structure, no anatomical change in the structure. Okay, C for coagulopathy, any sort of clotting disorders can lead to clotty blood, which is very common also. Then O for any sort of ovulatory disorders, when there is ovulation is not there, anovulation. We know when there is no ovulation, then again there will be no secretion of progesterone, there is only secretion of estrogen, and that can also lead to many other things like in PCOS, like endometrial disorders like endometriosis. Then I for iatrogenic, when there is overuse of medicines or sometimes we give those things or surgical treatment. And N for non-specified, when you don't find anything, then it's a non-specified cause. Coming to the structural, P for polyps. So polyps are also very common. A for adenomyosis. L for leiomyoma, that is fibroid. L for leiomyoma or fibroid. And M for malignancy. So malignancy like CA cervix is one of the cancer of cervix where there is abnormal uterine bleeding. And then leiomyoma is the fibroid. A for adenomyosis and P for polyps. So we'll go one by one, okay? So first we'll try to understand what are polyps. So what are polyps? Now polyps are of two types. They may be sessile or they may be pedunculated. Okay, they may be sessile, which one has a broad base, and sometimes it may have a stalk or a stem like thing, we call it pedunculated. And remember one thing, pedunculated are more common polyps. Okay, so some polyps are like this because the base is attached there, and some polyps are have a stalking thing. So some polyps are, this has a stalk, it is pedunculated, and this is sessile. So some polyps can grow so much that the polyp can come out of the cervix also. Okay, it can grow so much, and sometimes it can come out of the cervix and it can grow more, and okay, it can grow tall and tall, it can grow long and long. Okay, you can see the peduncle, polyp like that. So why polyps are important? Remember, in the other case, polyps are almost, they carry 25% of the cases of abnormal uterine bleeding. Okay, so you should think of polyp first rather than thinking of adenomyosis, fibroma. Polyps are very common, and they almost consist, I told you, they consist of 25% of cases. So why? And they are important because they can cause bleeding, excessive bleeding. Okay, and you know, they are soft, they are small, and there can be single, there can be multiple also. Okay, so it depends upon the location. So any sort of signs and symptoms in polyp depends upon the location, where it is located. Now if polyp is located here, you see this, I'm talking about this polyp. If the polyp is located here, can you think there will be implantation? So when there is a fertilization, there is implantation here. So if the polyp is located here or here, then when there is a fertilized embryo come, so there is a problem in implantation. So polyps are one main cause of infertility. It also can cause infertility. And nowadays it is very popular because IVF is very popular, in vitro fertilization. And polyps is major cause for failure of IVF, remember. If you did not scan the patient properly and did not remove the polyp before you go for IVF, then it will cause a major IVF failure. That's why polyps is one of the major cause for IVF failure, remember that. So that's why polyps are very important. Apart from that, what else is more important than this? The polyps are precancerous. If the polyps, you have not removed it, it can go for precancerous, it can become cancer. So that's why polyps, though they are small, they are soft, they can be notorious at the time, because polyps is also one of the main cause for miscarriage. Repeated miscarriage, you must scan the patient and look for any polyp there. Because if I told you, if polyp is here or located here, then there is no chance of implantation. Okay, and it will gradually lead to miscarriage. So one of the thing is that it is miscarriage, but another thing that it is always, though it is cancer, but it is a benign condition. Okay, there is no metastasis for this. And what else? Okay, there are some risk factors also for polyps. These polyps are mostly found, what are the risk factors? They are mostly found in obese people, hypertensive people, like adenomyosis. And one thing, it has been, the research, when I've done the research, it has been found that polyps are most found in women who eat a lot of processed foods or red meat. Okay, that is also a close relation. A lot of research has been done about this. Other than this, what else can do? Polyps can cause infertility, it can cause miscarriage, it can cause a lot of bleeding, precancerous though it is benign condition, and there is intermenstrual bleeding. When you say intermenstrual bleeding, mean the bleeding that occurs between the period of menstruation, that also is mostly by the pedunculated polyps. Intermenstrual bleeding, I just write IMB, intermenstrual bleeding, is also one of the sign and symptom of polyp. Okay, so then we go to the adenomyosis. So after polyp P, we go for A, that is adenomyosis. So understand, adenomyosis, you must understand the uterine layers. Okay. Remember when there is the endometrium, so if you take a piece of endometrium, you'll find a layer here, endometrium. Okay. So there's the first layer called functional layer. Functional layer. Then there is a bottom layer called basalis layer. Okay, these are the endometrium. So there is a columnar epithelium here. So this whole part is called endometrium. So below the endometrium, normally in every tissue, there is a mucosa, this is the mucosa, and there is a submucosa, and there is the muscle layer. But uterine muscle is a unique layer that don't have submucosa. Okay? That don't know has no submucosa. So after the endometrial layer, which is the two layers, functional layer and basalis layer, there is a direct start of the myometrium. Okay? Muscle layer. This is the smooth muscle layer. So smooth muscle layer. So what I'm trying to say, look here, the layer is just continuous with the endometrium. The muscle layer is continuous with the endometrium. This is the endometrium, which is divided into upper functional layer and lower basalis layer. Okay? So there is a continuation here. There is no proper, because in other tissues there is a submucosal layer. But in uterus, what is there? Absence of submucosal layer. Absence of submucosal layer. Absence of submucosal layer. So this is the endometrium. And this is the myometrium. Then there is a layer of perimetrium. Okay, adventitia. So what is there in this? So when there is a menstruation, this functional layer is usually shed off. When there is menstruation, this functioning layer is shed off and the basalis layer is remained. So what is there in the functional layer? We have lot of glands. Okay, and there's corkscrew blood vessels, if you remember from menstruation. Okay, so there are some blood vessels here. And they are glands, typical glands. Okay, so during menstruation, this part is shed off. Okay, so now what happens in adenomyosis? This some endometrial layer has gone up to the muscle layer. Okay, there is a penetration of this endometrium. We don't know the exact reason, but what do we see in the microscope? We see that these endometrial glands are found here. Endometrial glands are found here with endometrial tissues. So if you compare with endometriosis, it's the same. In endometriosis, endometrial tissue are found, but they are found other than uterus. They are found endometriosis, and you will find endometrium here and there in the pelvic regions. Okay? So that is very common fact. Now what is the difference here? Look here. The endometrial layer is, yes, it has extended to here, it has extended up to the myometrial layer. But the blood vessels are not extended. But the blood vessels of the endometrial are not extended. That's why, when there is estrogen level and the progesterone level, you know, this is, endometrium means estrogen. Remember one thing, endometrium is dependent on estrogen. Okay, so when the endometrium bleeds during menstruation, in endometriosis, this thing also bleed. And there is formation of clots or hemorrhage. But in contrast to adenomyosis, here there is no bleeding because blood vessels are not migrated. Only the glands are migrated. So there is no bleeding in the myometrial layer. So bleeding that occurs, adenomyosis is one of the cause for abnormal uterine bleeding. Bleeding occurs because there is excessive proliferation of blood vessels here. Though there is migration, but these blood vessels are proliferated here. So there is excessive uterine bleeding. But the difference is that there is no formation of hemorrhage, no clot in adenomyosis. There is no clot formation in contrast to endometriosis. In the endometriosis, there will be clot and hemorrhage. But in adenomyosis, yes, there will be muscular defect. There will be a cosmetic defect. The whole thing will be now, because it has gone to the muscle layer, this muscle layer will what happen? It will stretch. So as a result, this uterus will look like this. It can stretch. It will become thick because of the growing myometrium. Okay, inside the myometrium, why the myometrium is swelling? Because endometrial tissue is making it swollen. Okay, so it can become thick. So that is basic difference between adenomyosis and endometriosis. Common facts, both are ectopic when the endometrial tissue has gone, but here in case in endometriosis, tissues has gone outside the uterus, but in adenomyosis, tissues are inside the uterus. Inside the uterus, just it has migrated to myometrial layer. So there is bleeding. Yes, there is bleeding because of increased proliferation of blood vessels. There is bleeding, which is more than 80 ml, obviously. That's why we put it in abnormal uterine bleeding. When it is more than 80 ml, we put it in abnormal uterine bleeding. So there is bleeding. And this is also estrogen dependent. So when estrogen goes high during proliferative phase, this functional layer proliferates, and here also it proliferates. So this myometrium goes thick. What is the basic difference between adeno and endometriosis? Adenomyosis mostly occurs in 40 to 50 years of women. In the late part, means it's a premenopausal condition, you can say. In the late part. So they are multiparous. In contrast to endometriosis, they are mostly young women and nullipar. Okay, so if the question like sometimes comes that a 26 year old female complaining of dysmenorrhea, menorrhagia, nullipara, then you will think about, because 26 years and young, and you will think about endometriosis. Okay, but if the same case, when you just change the age number, that 40 year old female, multipara, then you will think about adenomyosis. Okay, you will think about adenomyosis. So in adenomyosis, you see what the things can happen, because it is growing. It can reduce the, it can cause problem in implantation. So there is bleeding, there is chance of infertility, and because it is becoming heavy. So when the uterus load of the uterus growing big, when the volume of the uterus is growing big, like in fibromyoma or adenomyosis, one thing is very common in most of these conditions is backache, low backache. So now you know the anatomy, you should tell me why there is backache when the uterus is growing heavy, like in adenomyosis or fibromyoma. So can anyone tell me why there is backache in those conditions? So look here, what is happening here? Here we are increased uterine volume, or the weight is increasing. Weight of the uterus is increasing. So when the weight of the uterus is increasing, why there is backache, like in fibromyoma? There is lots of big fibroid form in the myometrium. Like in adenomyosis, it's a very common complaint, low backache. So why there is backache? Can someone tell me? Can anyone of you, can please try? Why? What is the reason that there is backache?
Compression of nerves.
Compression of? Nerves, okay. We take it as a point, compression of nerves. Any other thing? So, backache and...
Would it be weight on the uterosacral ligament?
Yes, very good. This is the same cause, because there is, when there is dyspareunia or low backache. So, let me explain you that thing. So, we know this is the uterus. And in front of the uterus, there is a bladder, okay? This is the bladder, this is uterus. What is it behind? There is a uterosacral ligament, which is a stick-like a ligament. And there is a sacrum here. Okay, there is a sacrum here. Forget about the rectum now. Okay, there is a sacrum here. So this is always in this manner. Now we are increasing. Suppose this uterus is 1 kilogram, we have increased it to 5 kilograms. So what is happening? it is in a stress. This part is stress. It is not able to support it. So when the pressure is going out, then it can cause problem here and can cause backache. Yeah, go. It can cause backache. Okay, so this is the reason why there is low backache. Yes, there will be low backache because sacrum is in the lower side of the spine. Okay, so when the uterosacral ligament can no longer take the weight of this uterus, because uterus is now growing, it is growing heavy, whether there is fibroid or adenomyosis, the ultimate outcome is abnormal bleeding and growing volume and or increasing weight. So it cannot take the pressure anymore, so the pressure will be transmitted, so it will influence this, it will influence, it has a greater impact of this our sacral vertebrae and can cause backache. This is the reason why there is dyspareunia also, when the uterosacral ligament is influence, and that can cause painful sexual intercourse. Alright, so most of the time, yes, there is a in adenomyosis, they are in 4th or to 5th decade, and there is sometimes history of surgery. So we don't know the reason exactly why there is adenomyosis, that why that endometrial tissue migrates. Okay, but we know that if there is history of surgery, any sort of surgical intervention in the early life, it can lead to, that's a risk factor, it can lead to adenomyosis in later part of the life, and also very closely related to tamoxifen. If you remember tamoxifen, can anyone tell me what is the uses of tamoxifen? You heard this name before, can someone tell me? What is tamoxifen? Okay, let me ask someone. Okay, who can tell me what is tamoxifen drug? Have you heard of it, tamoxifen? Akanksha Sharma.
Sir, it's used for breast cancer.
Yeah, it is for breast cancer. Yes, good. Tamoxifen is used to... Now, that's why you don't confuse when the question... Because you will get one question for tamoxifen in year 4, year 5, year 6. It's very common MCQ. Okay? Now listen, tamoxifen is used to cure breast cancer, but tamoxifen can cause endometrial hyperplasia or endometrial cancer also, or adenomyosis also, because this is the drug which is antagonist in breast tissue and partial agonist in endometrium, partial agonist for endometrial tissue. Okay, so in the breast tissue, though, both the breast tissue and they are related to estrogen, right? Breast tissue is also related to when estrogen goes high, there can be chances of breast cancer. So in breast cancer, it's obstruct. It decrease the level of estrogen and is used in treatment of breast cancer. So that's why it is called selective endometrial receptor modulator, SERM. Okay, selective endometrial receptor modulator. So in breast tissue, it is an antagonist, but when you use it in endometrial, it is a partial agonist. Okay, it is also closely related to as a risk factor for endometrial carcinoma. So that's the problem here. So tamoxifen is also very closely related to, when it has been researched, I've seen that overuse of tamoxifen can also cause adenomyosis. But why there is endometrial migration, we exactly don't know. Okay. So one thing is that sometimes question comes, is there any fertility issue in adenomyosis? So because we have seen that in polyps can cause infertility, but adenomyosis is not so closely related to fertility issues, because we know that in adenomyosis is basically occurs in 40 to 50 and almost multipara, so they have already completed their family. So infertility is not a big issue for in cases of adenomyosis. Okay, so that's about adenomyosis, and next we go for fibromyoma. So what is the fibromyoma? It's a leiomyoma. It is also called fibroid, and there is a growth of mass. There's a growth of the, it is also estrogen dependent, and there's a growth of mass in the myometrial tissue. We don't know the etiology here also. Okay. So now let's try to understand what is how will you classify it. Look, sometimes this cavity, this what is called fibroid, can grow inside the muscle. Okay. So it can be here. So when it is here, you see it's not disturbing anything. It's not disturbing anything. It's when the fibroid is in the myometrium and it is not going out, or it is not even disturbing the fallopian tube. It's not, so that's why 50% of cases of fibroid, they are asymptomatic. They're asymptomatic. So it's not disturbing anything. So it disturbs when it comes to the polyp sometimes, and that is very Now if the fibroid is growing like this, then it can create a problem in implantation. It can cause infertility, it can cause pain. We'll come to that. So when it is located in the myometrium and not doing anything, now look, this is totally in the muscle, they're not coming out, not going everywhere, anywhere. So we call this intramural. Intramural. This is the intramural type of fibroid. But sometimes this fibroid comes like a polyp with a pedunculated. Okay. So then, and it is in the cavity now. Now we will say it's the intracavitary. But the most problematic fibroid is when it is in the submucosa. Now though there is no submucosa here, but it is below the mucosa, so we call it as a submucosal fibroid. Now why this is problematic? Listen, this is the endometrium and it is close to the mucous layer. Here there is the implantation takes place. So when there is a submucosal fibroid, it will cause miscarriage. It will inhibit the implantation. Okay. Plus, what will happen? There is, in long run, there will be, so because it is influencing the endometrium here, this submucosal, it will cause lots of bleeding. So bleeding, infertility, which comes in MCQs, which is the most commonest fibroid to cause abnormal uterine bleeding. So you will say submucosal. So this submucosal fibroid is a basic factor for related to what you call infertility, because it is located here. And when there is a ovary will come, it will look for implantation. So it is inhibiting the implantation, it is causing lots of bleeding. Okay, it can cause miscarriage in comparison to intramural. But when there is intramural, it is always asymptomatic. So when you say fibromyoma, though it is estrogen dependent, but the signs and symptoms are dependent upon the location. So where there is located. Now some fibroid may be located here near to the adventitia, not going this way. So this fibroid is growing this way, but some fibroid is growing this way. So if it is here, and this fibroid is growing big, then what is called? Below the serosa, so subserosal. So subserosal. So in subserosal, what will happen? There can be pain. Okay, when it is growing size, it can lead to a lot of pain. Okay, again, low backache because of the influence of that to the uterosacral ligament. And what else can happen here? So some fibroid can be very close to cervix here. So we call it the cervical. So it's easy to remember, classify the fibroid. You don't need to remember. Okay, just remember the anatomy. Number one is there is an intramural, which is not disturbing anything. Number two is intracavitary fibroid classification. Number three is submucosal. Number four is cervical. Number four is subserosal. So there are five types. We can classify in five types of fibroid. Now the question, most common question in MCQs, which one is common for bleeding? Bleeding is submucosal. It's close to the mucosa. So obviously this is a common sense. If it's close to mucosa, so endometrial bleeding will be more. Which fibroid is commonest cause for what do you call infertility? Submucosa. Submucosal fibroid. Which fibroid is commonest cause for miscarriage? Submucosal. Which fibroid is commonest for asymptomatic fibroid? Intramural. It's not disturbing anything. But what are the complications here? Now, complications, which is the most complicated? Complicated is intracavitary. If you see, there is a stalk here. there is a stem here which can rotate sometimes like torsion. It can have a complication like torsion. So if it rotates, then what will happen? There will be venous occlusion. The veins will be occluded here. What we call as red degeneration. So when there is a red degeneration of fibroid, it can cause pain and vomiting. Remember that. Pain plus vomiting. If there is red degeneration. Otherwise, there is not much problem. Most of the fibroids are asymptomatic. Okay. So, what are the other things? So, fibroid is mostly associated. And one more thing, it is very commonly found in obese again. It is, yes, it is benign. What are the risk factors? It is benign and mostly asymptomatic, yes, and estrogen dependent. As the estrogen grows high, fibroid size will grow high, and obese and nulliparas are more very common. Obese and nullipara, they are more common. And yes, other symptoms, signs and symptoms are same. There will be dyspareunia, like any like other adenomyosis, endometriosis. There will be dyspareunia. There will be low backache, and yes, one more thing that you should notice, that when the fibroid will become big, yes, uterus will become big. No, now we know in the anatomy that uterus lies on the bladder. So this is uterus and here is the bladder. So if the uterus is growing big, what will happen? It can give pressure to the bladder. So increased frequency of urine or increased micturition is one of the signs and symptoms. Sometimes patient will come with just increased frequency of urine and you are checking sugar, everything is normal. Then you have to take the menstrual history. Okay, then you have to take the menstrual history and you will find that there is, or you do ultrasound. Which ultrasound? You will do obviously transvaginal sonography. You will find that there is lots of fibroids. So as I told you, it is basically asymptomatic. Yes, but when this fibroid is growing, with every menstruation there is high estrogen. When it's growing, yes, uterus will be heavy and it can compress the bladder, leading in problem in micturition. Okay? That is one of the thing that you should not miss when a female come with increased micturition and you don't get anything in blood. All the clinical features are, all the signs and symptoms are normal. So don't forget to do a TVS, transvaginal sonography. And you'll find that there is a fibroid which is growing big and big and big. And that's why it's giving pressure to the urinary bladder. So how will you treat? So treatment is for fibroid. We know, we discussed these things. Is OCP, low dose OCP is very important here. It can cause, and mifepristone is important for treatment, and progesterone only can give. Okay, because we are trying to neutralize the estrogen because it's growing because of estrogen. So we are trying to counteract the estrogen. That's why you can give progesterone. So basically the treatment is in direction of progesterone. So painkillers are very essential. Now why pain is there in all this, whatever we discuss in polyps, in adenomyosis, in fibroid, okay, which we already discussed this, adenomyosis, fibroid, leiomyoma and polyps. Pain is, if you go to physiology background, that pain is due to increased prostaglandins. So in all these cases, there is increased prostaglandins secreted. So we should basically give those painkillers that can suppress these prostaglandins, like tranexamic acid, okay, all those things. So you have to kill the pain, and then you can give the painkillers, OCP. And last resort is always hysterectomy if she completed the family. That is the last resort. Otherwise, we'll always try to treat with medical side. Okay, so that's about abnormal uterine bleeding. So when you classify according to the book, like structural, non-structural. Structural are palm and non-structural coin. Alright, so that's for today. Alright, so we have discussed the abnormal uterine bleeding, and I think if you have any question, you can ask me now. So do you have any questions or it's okay? Okay, please go ahead.
What would be the difference between a polyp and an intracavity fibroid?
Yes, that is very good. That's a very good question. So when you get an intracavitary fibroid or when you get a polyp, it's very difficult to diagnose. It's very difficult to diagnose. The only thing is that here in the intracavity, the estrogen level will be very high. Otherwise, it's very difficult to diagnose. So when you remove it, ultimately is removal. Polyp must be removed. Polyp cannot go of its own. But adenomyosis, it after menstruation, I mean after menopause, they go of their own. Menopause is the best treatment for adenomyosis. Remember, when there is menopause, adenomyosis goes of its own. When there is menopause, endometriosis goes of its own. But polyp don't go of its own. But you cannot wait for 50 years to see, or 45 years to see whether it goes off or not. So both should be removed. That's a very good question and interesting, that if there is an intracavitary polyp, intracavitary fibroid, or there is a pedunculated polyp, which is very common than sessile, then it is very, very difficult to diagnose. So only thing is that you grab that thing, remove it, and send it for biopsy. Then only you can diagnose. Okay?
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. So any other questions?